Welcome. My name is Haris Aziz, and I'll be hosting this particular seminar. So it's my great pleasure to invite Professor Wolfgang Reif, who is based at University of Augsburg. I've been at several institutions in Sydney, including NICTA, CSIRO, and UNSW, and Professor Reif has been a visitor to all of these institutions. In fact, he's been here at least 5 times. So I'll just give a quick introduction to Professor Reif's bio. He's a full professor of computer science at University of Augsburg, Germany, where he heads the Institute for Software and Systems Engineering. He also leads the Bavarian Elite Program on Software Engineering and was the founding dean of the Faculty of Computer Science and also member of the Executive Board of University of Augsburg. Professor Reif holds a diploma and a doctoral degree of computer science from University of Karlsruhe, Germany, and he has several research interests, including software engineering, safety and security, formal methods, software-driven robotics, and self-organizing and adaptive systems. Today in the seminar, he's going to talk about swarm intelligence as a programming paradigm, self-organizing systems. It's a pleasure to welcome you. It's all yours. Thank you.
So thank you for the introduction. Thank you for the invitation. I really am grateful for the time here with UNSW.ai. The talk is basically on self-organizing systems, and I found it quite interesting to see that that the swarm intelligence is a good, suitable programming model to implement that kind of systems. Let me just say some words about my background. I'm heading the Institute for Software and Systems Engineering. This is Augsburg's Center for Software Research. Harris mentioned already the Bavarian Elite Graduate Program. This is interesting because it's a joint program between three universities, the Technical University of Munich and the LMU Munich and the University of Augsburg joined forces for the Bavarian software elite education. And so that's for Germany, that's quite unusual to do that. But it's a real pleasure to work with those students. So the Institute has some AI-related research topics, automated reasoning, robotics, machine learning, with a focus on production and swarm intelligence. And I would like to show you three visible results of our work. The first one is KIV. That's an interactive theorem prover, which is mainly used for software and systems verification. And one example was MasterCard's Mondex cash card. There we verified the security protocol. And this is another visible result of our work. This is the most recent lightweight robot by KUKA called Eva. KUKA is a robot manufacturer. It's world market number 3, headquartered in Augsburg. And the special thing about this robot is that the force torque sensors are integrated in all joints of the robot. And it was a cooperation. The force torque sensors and the control theory come from DLR, that's the German Aerospace Center, and the software architecture comes from my institute. So we have a long list of research grants. This is the largest project we are currently involved in. This is the AI production network in Augsburg. It's a part of the Bavaria's high-tech agenda, funded by two ministries, the Ministry of Science and the one of Economy. They funded with 92 million euro for 5 years for AI research in production. The reason for this special focus on industrial production is that in the region of Augsburg, roughly 40% of the jobs are directly or indirectly in this area, in this field. And scientifically, it's also a very interesting application area because of its chronic data anemia. So So that's the major problem there, and you have to figure out how to deal with that. Yeah, does that help? So this is outline of the talk. First, we'd like to go through the motivation, focus on a special class of systems, then show how to control emergent behavior in self-organizing systems, how to monitor these, and how distributed control is possible. And in the end, I would like to show you some an application. So the basic goal is to create, or at least to contribute to IT systems that solve problems by nature-inspired techniques, such as self-organization, self-adaptation, or self-optimization. These techniques, or that kind of system, is appropriate for systems where it's hard to foresee all critical situations in future, all potential changes in future, at design time. So the reasons for that might be complexity, autonomy, or the a priori unknown structure of the system that evolves over time. And these kind of systems need something else than classical software development. In classical software development, the decisions are taken at design time. A programmer tries to foresee the future. He or her tries to find all the figure out all the combinations that might occur and design the countermeasures. And self-organizing systems are completely different. The decisions are taken at runtime, and they use concepts from swarm intelligence. And I would like to show you three examples of swarm intelligence to just make clear what elements or what concepts we really use in our context. The first example is shoals of fish. You have interaction of simple components, of many components that might nevertheless produce intelligent swarm behavior. We call that emergent behavior or collective dynamics. And so the single components are the fish. They communicate with their neighbors through the sideline organ, and there's no central control, but they follow simple rules. The simple local rules are keep together and keep in motion. And the positive emergent collective behavior of that is that they form large structures that may scare or possibly repel predators. And this is the positive version, the positive case of emergent behavior. Most of these systems also have a negative side, negative emergent behavior. For example, when the swarm is circumvented by predators, then the only degree of freedom these rules allow are rotation. And a rotating swarm is easy prey for the predators. So here the message is, when looking at emergent behavior, we also have to make sure that we can control that. The second example is a crossing in Hanoi. And I just to show you the video. So I guess you see the point. Here the components are, there are many components. The components are cars, motorbikes, bikes, pedestrians. And the communication to the neighbors is done by vision and sound. And there are two simple rules that are keep moving towards your intended direction and avoid contact. So there's no central control, and nevertheless, these kind of crossings have, very often they have a higher throughput than the German versions of that, that are very controlled. And so the last example, to illustrate what emergent behavior can do, is a technical example. So here we have a network of components. These These circles are the components, and the network is fed with colored tokens from the left, and it delivers colored tokens to the right, and the components follow a very simple rule, namely to hand over the same color as before, unless forced otherwise by a timeout, for example. And the color tokens on the left-hand side, the color is random, and the neighbors are indicated by these arrows, and I'm starting a simulation of that, and during this setup, you can already try to find out what the emergent behavior would be. So this is the same situation. I just three colors, and there's a warm-up phase that every diesel engine requires, and after a while you see what the system really does. So the emergent behavior of this the collective dynamics is just a batch sorting. So, and isn't that great to try to program functions as the collective behavior of such a swarm? And why should we look into such systems? The answer is very easy, and I show you the reason why. So what I'm now doing, so these red squares, I destroy the components. Always to find the right moment. So now I destroyed 12.5% of the components, and think of your favorite software system where you destroy 10% of the components. What happens? Everything gets stuck. But what you see is the system is not very much impressed by this disturbance. And this is the reason why we are so interested in that kind of system, because they are resilient and they are robust to failures. So the basic goal is to engineer these self-X properties into technical systems, and we want the systems to be particularly resistant against disturbances. They should adapt to changing requirements and modified tasks, and optimize themselves for better performance. Easy to describe. The solutions are much harder because there are some challenges. The self-X systems make decisions at runtime on their own. They change the structure, behavior, etc. They are hard to predict. However, when you come to a company, practical applications need reliable behavioral guarantees. Otherwise, they will never be implemented in practical scenarios. So the first challenge is how to reconcile the self-X properties that makes them robust with guaranteed behavior and safety and other things. And the second point is, the second challenge is top-down engineering of such systems. So it's very easy to implement these systems. Just you have the components, give them rules, give them a communication possibility, and then look what happens. So it's very easy to do that bottom up, but it's much harder to do that top down. And the third challenge is to measure somehow the resilience, the self-X capacity that is in these systems, and compare that with classical solutions that use redundancy. So I will concentrate on the first two challenges in the talk. And we do not look at arbitrary systems. We define a specific class of systems that we would like to solve. And this is an example, adaptive production cell. It is more a caricature of a production cell, very much simplified, but nevertheless, you see the point. So there are three robots. The first one, they will deal with work pieces, and the work, the work pieces, the first one drills a hole, the second inserts a screw, and the third one tightens the screw. So that's the scenario, and all three have all three capabilities, so they can switch them. So the unprocessed workpiece comes into the comes to the first robot. The robot drills a hole, puts the workpiece on a cart and an AGV, and this transports it to the second one. The second one inserts the screw, transports it to the third. The third one tightens it, and then the processed workpiece leaves the cell. And this works quite a while, and then something happens. The drill breaks of the first one, and in a classical scenario, then the cell would stop. Somebody had to, would come and repair that, and for that, so, and we would expect from an adaptive or self-organizing cell, we would expect that they find out that this is not the end, that, for example, the third one could drill the hole. Instead, the first one tightens the screw, and the second one stays with the task he had, or the capability, that the role that he had before. And then they change capabilities, and then everything seems to be okay, but is not. We expect that also the cards now find out that the transportation order has to be reversed, otherwise it wouldn't work. So, and so we would expect that this is done automatically without human interaction. So that's part of the self-organization. And there's another complication. Suppose we now have a second type of workpiece coming in, one with a prefabricated hole in it. And then we expect from a adaptive production cell that the cell finds out on its own that the workpiece should be transported right to the second one and not to the first one. And another complication is that we would like to dynamically integrate a new robot, and we would expect that the cell finds out that the middle one here, the middle guy, is a bottleneck, and that the new one supports the bottleneck. So this roughly sets the scenario, and this is an example or an instance of an entire system class of resource flow, so flow production. This is the technical term, and so we describe this system class by this meta diagrams. It's a UML style diagram which tells there are agents. Agents have capabilities. The agents can play different roles, and the roles and the capabilities are applied to the resources, and the resources are such are processed in a way that the task is fulfilled. And you see here something called the virtual centralized observer controller. This component monitors the flow, triggers the reorganization if something goes wrong, and restores the flow after reorganization. Centralized observer controller is not meant as to be implemented. It's meant as a specification, because it's a central observation and control device. We do not want to have central control, but for specification, it's quite good. And later on, we find a distributed implementation of that. So the basic idea here is that the role reorganization is sufficient to restore the production flow. And so this reorganization is a very weak form of self-organization, but nevertheless, it's very already very powerful. And please note that the concrete reorganization algorithm was left completely open. So fixing the or describing the system class that way means that after that, the special applications are just instances of that. So agents are now the robots, the capabilities are drill, insert, tighten. The task is just a sequence of applying drill, insert, tighten to the resource. That's a very simple task. And the role is a bit more complicated. This central part of the role is the capability. And this is what the capability that has to be applied. And the first and this third component describe where the where it comes from which component it comes, what the task is, and what the intermediate state of execution is at that point. What happened to the work piece so far? And the third component says where it goes to, what the new task is, and what the new state of the intermediate state of execution is. So typically, state prime is just state with the current capability attached. Typically, the task prime is just task, but this has a degree of freedom to change the task at that point. And the allocation of roles to agents is just a mapping or a relation agent to roles. In the background, there is so-called I/O graph. This says who can communicate with whom or cooperate with whom, and the red arrows just form one flow through the production system. I think I skipped that, that's quite clear. And the idea is that we have a model-driven approach, a predefined generic domain model for the system class. This means we have a predefined dynamics and communication for the agents. And application modeling is then just instantiating the model elements with the application components. So that's a very nice thing. And then most of the code can be generated from the model, from the background model. And the entire thing runs on the multi-agent system. In our case, it's JADEX. Such a system gives you infrastructure for communication, messaging, role selection and execution, and all the other stuff. And also interfaces to domain and application specific extensions, because drilling a real hole in a real workpiece by a real robot is not just the letter D. So there's a lot of stuff behind that. And this is done with the interface to the extensions. So now it's clear what the system class is that we want to look at. And the question is, how can we let the system go on one hand, accepting decisions on its own? And on the other hand, how can we control that? And we came up with a very simple idea, and this is the idea of corridors of good behavior. So we call that the restore invariant approach, and the idea is we describe a corridor of acceptable behavior, and we guarantee that the system stays in that corridor, doesn't leave it, but we have no idea what it does within the corridor. So if you would like to avoid a certain behavior, then you should make clear that this is outside this corridor. So this is the instrument that we use. And the corridor is defined by an invariant. The goal of the system then is just to preserve this invariant as long as ever possible. Temporary violation of the invariant triggers the reorganization. And the idea is that reorganization restores the invariant again, and then the system continues, and failure occurs if the restoring of the invariant is no longer possible. For example, if there's no drill available anymore, then there is no repair. And this leads to following segmentation of the traces here at the bottom. We have a working phase where the invariant holds, then something happens, then the reorganization is triggered, the reconfiguration phase starts. During that phase, the invariant is violated, and restoring the invariant means that afterwards the thing continues working and the invariant still holds. So the invariant describes the corridor, and the corridor guarantees that the system doesn't do any harm. So since we are, and the invariant is described as a conjunction of a number of runtime checkable first order formulas, there are 10 or so, and the first one says each needed capability can still be performed by some of the agents. Otherwise, the goal cannot be achieved anymore. And the formula below says that in formal terms. The second property says that resources are handed over only to fitting agents. This just means that what the receiving agent expects is what the sending agent offers, that this fits together. This are consistency properties, and we have a number of them. And since we are a formal methods guys as well, we formalize that and have a theorem in the end. I'll come back to that later. And what are the behavior that we expect? We expect that the first property says that resources in the system are always processed according to the task. And the second says resources leaving the system are always completed. So this means it works correctly. And this is the guarantee that we can give to companies applying techniques like that. And but we cannot exactly tell what the system does in the meantime. So, and since we formulated all the invariants and the dynamic behavior, etc., we could prove the theorem that these two properties P1 and P2 together called prop hold in resource flow systems as long as the invariant can be restored by the reconfiguration mechanism. And the first part of the formula below, this is just a specification. This is the specification of the observer controller responsible for restoring the invariant. And then this is put in parallel to the agents, HE1 to HEN. And then we can show that the properties indeed hold. And this means that the system safely stays within the specified corridor, at least in the working phases. So now we have a means to control or to control the positive emergent behavior. And the next question is, how do we monitor that? And so we have a typical situation here. Below you find, this is the system under observation and control, and the invariant is monitored by an observer, and the controller contains the reconfiguration algorithm, and then the new configuration is just deployed to the system below. Forget about the result checker. Those who are interested, I could comment on that later. So first of all, how do we specify such an observer controller? We do that using a technique that comes from formal methods. This is rely guarantee. That's a typical proof technique in temporal logic. And the rely says the reconfiguration is only controlled by the observer controller. And the guarantee is that after reconfiguration, the invariant is restored. The observer controller doesn't interfere with the productive system in working phases, and the observer controller only changes certain variables. That's not so important. And then with this rely and guarantee formulas, we can formulate what the specification is. And this is a so-called sustains formula. For those of you that are interested, R arrow plus G is just not R until not G. That's a typical thing in temporal logic. I would like to go back. So the question is still, it is a specification. It's unclear how the reconfiguration is done actually. And so we left the spectrum is completely open to application-specific algorithms or to bio-inspired or heuristic algorithms. But whatever you choose, you have this implementation should satisfy this specification. That's clear. And here we made an interesting observation. There exists a uniform solution for such an implementation. When you see it, it's not anymore. It's not surprising anymore. But we were surprised when we found that out, because the invariant restoration is just a constraint satisfaction problem. Here's the problem. What we look for is an assignment to the mapping from agent to roles, or roles are associated with agents. And with that assignment, the invariant holds. So if you read that, it means there exists an assignment such that a property holds for that assignment. This is a constraint satisfaction problem, because the invariant, if you recall, that's a conjunction of 10 constraints. So that's a constraint satisfaction problem. And the idea is to use a constraint solver as the reconfiguration algorithm. Isn't that great? And then we experimented with a couple of constraint solvers, CotCot and Cplex. And I would also like to mention MiniSync, which was developed. I think some of the people here in this building have been involved in the development. At the moment, the website says it's a development of Data 61 and Monash. It was a quite helpful tool to do that. So I had the impression that the MiniSync was the one that we liked most. It depends a bit. The constraints, the constraint solvers do not, they have different strategies, and you can tune them and so forth. And if you tune the one, you can achieve the same results as the other. And with the other, you can get that without tuning. So I'm not, it's not so important for me which one. Nevertheless, the MiniSync behaved quite well. And we extended MiniSync to MiniBras. MiniSync does hard constraints. So the invariant, the corridor is a hard constraints. And what we wanted to achieve, so one solution would be you stay in the corridor, but you bump at one boundary, then you're thrown back, you bump to the other side, thrown back, and that's not a good behavior. So this is safe, or it's correct, but it's not good. And therefore, we had the wish to keep the system somehow in the middle. And then we added constraints, more constraints, and the system gets over-constrained. And therefore, we have the corridor boundaries at the hard constraints, and all the other constraints that try to keep it in the middle are soft constraints. And so MiniBras is a constraint solver based on MiniSync, and which can deal with soft constraints. So soft constraints are those that you can violate partly, and it finds out which better to violate and which to keep.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I'm a fan. So compliments, good work. Okay, now we have a solution for the reconfiguration algorithm, but we still have one problem. Namely, we have the entire system consisting of many components, and then we have this centralized observer and the centralized controller, and we would like to get rid of that. And this is, there's an easy trick to do that. We just give every component an observer and every component a controller. And then we do the following. We locally monitor the invariance. If the invariant is violated, for example, a broken capability, then a reconfiguration is triggered and the agent with the broken capability becomes the observer controller. So it becomes the leader of a coalition formation process. Then in the first step, the leader asks itself, am I capable to repair that on my own? If not, I'll ask my neighbor, can we together do that? If no, then we ask another one. And so we find a coalition that is able to solve the problem and fit exactly in the context of the rest of the system. And the constraint solver is run on the coalition leader. So we find incrementally a minimal number of agents which together have the needed capabilities. We test if the resource flow is restored can be restored by these. Then we distribute the roles back and go back to the working phase. So we now got rid of a central control, but nevertheless, the constraint solver always needs to know all components that it is talking about. So the question is, how large or how big are the coalitions? And there we have an experimental observation for systems with enough redundancy. This is an important factor. The coalition sizes grow slowly, much slower than the number of agents. This means that even in large systems, the constraint satisfaction problem for the coalitions remains solvable at runtime, where the centralized CSP does not. So that's good luck. So I would like to show you an application of that we are working on this. This is a resource flow system, a self-organized high flex production. This is joint work with KUKA. And the basic idea here is that we replace our single robots by such a cell. And there are many of them. And these cells may change on their own. They are the tooling and thereby have getting other capabilities, and the AGVs, these mobile carts, they do all the logistics, and there's no central control. And then the idea is that it looks roughly like that. So the work pieces and the products search their own way through the capabilities. KUKA is a robot manufacturer. This was market number 3. It used to be a German company, but meanwhile it's Chinese. 98% owned by Media. So that's an interesting point in the process. The idea is that there a product change takes place. First they produce a van and later on a ute. And the question is, how does that fit into this organization? And I think I have to skip that. To fit that into the process, it may be that the cell must be, the tools must be replaced. And this is also done by the AGVs. They bring new tools. And so the production gets very flexible. And the application scenario, the use case for that kind of plant is when you have only very few specimen of a product, but you want automation for that. So typically, you get high automation only for mass production. Otherwise, the costs are too high. And this is a solution where you can get single individual products at the cost of mass production. So let me summarize. I've presented a framework for model-driven design of self-organizing resource flow systems. The system behavior is collective dynamics of a swarm. We found it for that system class a uniform solution. The control of the collective behavior is done with this corridor idea, and the framework of this observer controller keeps that within the corridor. This monitors the system, and with the distributed reconfiguration, we try to get rid of the central control. It heavily relies on techniques from constraint solving, of course, and from multi-agent systems. And we've extended, so we're still working on it. We've extended that to systems of systems. And that is important for distributed energy management that plays an enormous role in Germany, meanwhile, because we get out. So we are one of the few countries that get out of, at the same time, out of nuclear power, out of coal, and now out of gas. That's quite demanding. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much. I would like to thank my very inspiring research group. And as you know, they did a lot, if not the most, of the work. So thanks to them, and thanks to you for your attention.
Thanks a lot for a very exciting talk. We have some time for questions. So is anybody from the audience or the online participants? I also noticed that Professor Hossein Abbas from Canberra is here as well. He works a lot on swarm intelligence. Okay, so if there are no immediate questions, I'll go with the first one. So you've used multi-agent systems, constraint programming as well, formal methods. Are you exploring some other techniques in developing your systems? For example, learning, various forms of learning.
Yeah, so learning was applied already, but so when the constraint solver suggests a solution, it's not clear that this is the best one. Mm-hmm. You just get one, that can be a bad one. And if you have, so the idea was to learn to select better choices, and the criterion is that the survival rate of the system, so the degree of resilience, is higher with some solutions than with others. And so the idea was to somehow learn which solutions have lead to a higher resilience.
Any questions from the audience? One thing I was noticing was that you had a few references which were quite familiar on coalition formation in multi-agent systems. So which theoretical aspects from those papers did you implement in your framework?
This is quite standard. So there's no contribution by us that goes beyond that. Mm-hmm. So for us, we just stick to these techniques. And what we did is we had to make sure that the constraints, constraint problem still is complete, such that you can, so the important thing is that when you have a solution, a local solution, this must fit into the context. Then you could even, run the rest of the system could even continue during the reconfiguration of a smaller part. So, but the coalition formation, there's nothing new for us.
Okay. All right, in that case, I would like to thank again the speaker. Thank you so much for your invited talk. Thanks a lot for participation. Thank you.